Hello and welcome to the Zell Visiting Writers series. We are delighted to have Kathy Graber here with us this evening. I'll make a few administrative announcements before we get started. So this event is recorded and will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writers series YouTube channel. The basic structure is in a minute, I will turn it over to one of our MFA students, Sarah Afshar, to introduce Kathy. Kathy will then give a 20-25 minute-ish reading, and then she'll have about a 30-minute conversation with one of our MFA students, Julia McDaniel, and then we'll open it up for the last 30 minutes or so to audience questions. If you are an audience member and would like to submit a question, you can do so through the chat. You send it to all panelists. It's really nice if you can indicate when you submit your question a little bit about who you are. You know, if you're an MFA student, if you're a literary enthusiast from Seattle, you know, whoever you are, so that we can know a little bit about who we're talking to. Closed captioning is enabled, which you can turn on or off by pressing the CC icon on the bottom of your screen. And I will post in a minute, shortly after Sarah's introduction, a link to the reading for anyone who might find that helpful to follow along. So Sarah, I will turn it over to you to introduce Kathy.
Thanks, Ashley. The first poem in Kathleen Graber's most recent collection, The River Twice, ends with this image. A pair of pigeons unwittingly separated as one flies towards land and the other roosts on a ferry that begins to move in the opposite direction. While considering the pigeon flying away, the speaker asks, how will it know to simply sit and wait? And what of the panic of the one departed? The one who has left without leaving. In this past year, many of us have left without leaving. And some of us did not know to simply sit and wait. Our circumstances were incomprehensible. We already lived in a fractured nation among fractured families, as the river twice illustrates. Now we are fractured and under pressure. It makes sense that I turned to the river twice often this year. Poetry is language in its highest form, and I was at a loss for my own. It was comforting to grasp another's words. Quote, I feel a sudden sorrow, as though my emotions were a room I'd forgotten why I entered. The river twice is a title that invokes Heraclitus's idea that all things are in flux. The idea that the same person cannot step into the same river twice. Both are continually changing. Many people I know have felt so stuck in recent months, yet simultaneously acknowledge that they're changed completely as people. Graber writes that constant change may be not contrary to the nature of the cosmos, but fundamental to it. This is a collection of speakers who are becoming, not in the fixed state of being. They carefully observe and question the natural and political worlds within America described as the world body we live in, as if the constant search can quell bewilderment. The speakers are smart, empathetic, cynical in those observations. Graber writes, sometimes I forget that I cannot say I, or I assume that you know that when I say I mean we, or that I at least want to mean we, even when the grammar or the simple ethics of the situation seems to demand you, or worse yet, them. The truths in these poems are not pithy one-liners or intangible truisms. They are the speaker's eyes trying to open as widely as possible to absorb as much as they can from a single scene. The encapsulation of such simultaneity requires concentrated language. The words of these poems take up full pages and then are further explicated by precise notes and long epigraphs. A Approximations may be easier to digest, but they can be dangerous. To this end, Graber includes an epigraph before her poem, A Rhetoric, meditation on language and its contemporary powers and purposes. It's one of Heraclitus's fragments. I think it's one of the fragments. It goes, they that are awake have one world in common, but the sleeping, each turns aside into a world of his own. In America, Flight, Graber writes into an example of the separate worlds America lives. On the plane, I sat between a Jehovah's Witness and a student of cognitive psychology on his way to a job at a memory lab. She read aloud her favorite passages about love and judgment. She said, "The Lord gave us a chance to be gardeners, and look at what we've done." Despite relaying that sentiment of seeming disapproval, the speakers in this collection are not hopelessly critical. In the final line of the same poem, the speaker implores America, "Give me your hand in the dark." I see this as yearning, a yearning for collective betterment, a yearning that is highlighted in 8 epistle-like poems within The River Twice that address our nation directly, singularly, in a frank and tender way. Each America poem is an example of feedback one can only get via generosity, through careful time and dutiful attention. The act of observation is not hopeless. Here it's an act of caring. There is love in the stark noticing of produce and decay in America peaches. It is a fruit like the mind we are making together, both overripe and immature. These are notes of, in Graber's words, compassion rather than cruelty. They are a poet's civic engagements, letters written to the biggest city hall of all. There were many times this past year I invoked the question posed in America October. America, how do we feel as we hover again under the lintel, caught between stoic resolve and of life in a way I have yet not? Or maybe we are all the unwitting cause of others' disruptions, a bunch of ferry boat captains just trying to leave on time. The speakers of The River Twice ponder what Heraclitus asserts, that there is harmony between this creature who listens to the world through its open mouth and the poet who listens to her dog chew an antler, while the moon is a thing rung in an empty tree. The snow glowing at night could be a radiant unread scripture from another world. Kathleen Graber has written 3 books, Correspondence, Eternal City Poems, and The River Twice. She was a finalist for the National Book Award and the National Book Critics Circle Award. Her other honors include a Rona Jaffe Writers Award, an artist fellowship from the New Jersey State Council on the Arts, and a Hodder Fellowship in creative writing at Princeton University. She's also been granted an Amy Lowell Poetry Traveling Scholarship, and last year she won the Rilke Prize from UNT for The River Twice. She previously taught English at the high school level and at New York University. Currently, she teaches at the Creative Writing Program at Virginia Commonwealth University. Please join me in welcoming Kathleen Graber.
Sarah, thank you so much. That was an absolutely beautiful and really moving introduction, and I am grateful to you for putting the poems into our contemporary context. I'm going to try to read some of the poems that you have quoted. Anyway, thank you again. And thank everyone at Michigan for inviting me here. I'm just thrilled to be here. I had a wonderful morning meeting with MFA students who are talented and sweet and fun. Okay, so I'm going to begin with the poem, The River Twice, which is the title poem from the book, The River Twice. And you, as Sarah said, you probably all know this saying, you can't step in the same river twice. And so that's the title's meant to be a play on that. So I live in Richmond now. This poem is set in Richmond, and there is in Richmond, I have not been there in a year, a gigantic thrift store called Love of Jesus. And it's a true place. They have a Facebook page. You can look it up. I'll give my plug to Love of Jesus. The River Twice. The Love of Jesus is a thrift warehouse on the south side of town. Everything inside is a dollar. On Mondays and Fridays, everything is 50 cents. A stormy afternoon in June, and I drift for hours down the aisles. Bread machines and coffee pots, shirts and shoes, teetering stacks of mismatched dinnerware. I am studying a cup whose crackled glaze is the pale blue-green of beach glass. Two lions chase one another around its fragile eternity, the way the lover pursues the beloved on the ancient urn, their manes and legs washed in a preternatural purple and gold. Behind me, a woman tells her son William to get up from the floor so she can measure him against a pair of little boy's jeans. When he doesn't rise, she tells him she is going to start counting. She says she is only going to count to two. When I look over, he is already on his feet at silent attention, his arms outstretched at his sides. I live in an attic apartment above two women who have been unemployed as long as I have known them. This week, the last of their benefits have been unexpectedly terminated by the state. A drop in the overall number of jobless automatically triggers a cessation of extensions, the letter that comes in the mail explained. Outside, thunder cracks. Later, the streets will be full of limbs. Heraclitus believed that in the beginning, creation simply bubbled forth, an inevitable percolating stream, logos, both reason and word, issuing from a source unseen. Sometimes I feel a sudden sorrow, as though my own emotions were a room I'd forgotten why I entered. My mother struck me only once for refusing to put on my coat. I was 4 years old and she had been scrubbing motel rooms all day. I'd fallen asleep in the dark on a low shelf in the linen closet beside the boxes of little pink soaps. Today, that shelf is gone and the great white polar caps are melting. At Kasungu National Park in Malawi, a drought has caused the lions to turn on the rangers whose job it is to protect them. Our skulls are chipped bowls, broken globes, we plunge into the flow. Heraclitus, whom the crash of time has left in fragments, saw in the cosmos a harmony of tensions. Imagine the lyre, he wrote, and the bow. The store radio plays satellite gospel, a hymn with the chorus, "Every moment you shall be judged," is followed by one in which the choir shouts praise, stand up and be forgiven. So I'm gonna jump around from book to book to book. So Heraclitus is essentially the star of the River Twice. Marcus Aurelius is the star of the Eternal City. He was a Roman emperor, and so the Eternal City is Rome. And so I'm just gonna read one of these. There are 12 poems. Each one of them is in conversation with one of Aurelius's meditations. I'm gonna read book three, and it's got a little epigraph from Aurelius at the top. They know not how many things are signified by the words stealing, sowing, buying, keeping quiet, seeing what ought to be done. For this is not affected by the eyes, but by another kind of vision. Marcus Aurelius. Remember the Quadi and the Parthians. Never allow them into your life. Last night at work, before I knew it, while I was busy selling a t-shirt, the one with the glow and the dark skeleton in the electric chair to Canadian tourists, an addict convinced me to keep an eye on his six-year-old son. Slurring something as simple as don't let him go nowhere, he turned and stepped into the Congress of night strollers on the boardwalk. Where did he go? The child wondered. After 10 minutes, he asked, how long has he been gone? Soon though, the father returned, stood in the doorway of the shop, called his son's name once, and they vanished. In his relief, the boy forgot the jarred goldfish he'd won by tossing a coin into the bowl. At midnight, I placed it into the open hand of a sunburnt girl wearing thick black glasses, knee-high socks, and a 14-gauge surgical steel lip ring. Having lost, somewhere in the past, the urge to take so grave a responsibility upon myself. The fish will die. Maybe it's dead already. And I'm tired of feeling sad. What is this other kind of vision that recognizes already the end in sight, that foresees only disaster? Today, I'm giving away two bags of clothing I've never worn, and then I'm going to run in place at the gym while I listen to Moby Dick on tape. We discussed puppets and how much he likes the big blocks at school. We considered how slowly time seems to pass when you're waiting. So let's see, two things. One is I forgot to mention that most of my life I was a public school teacher in the winter time, in the off season, and in the on season, in the summer season, I operated a little record shop on the boardwalk in New Jersey. And so this is a poem about selling a Metallica t-shirt. So it probably seems like a strange occupation for a poet, but I did that for a good long time. Okay, so from the Roman Empire to the Magic Kingdom. This is the opening poem from The Eternal City, and it is really a reference in this context to Disney World. It has an epigraph from St. Augustine. And as in the daily casualties of life, every man is, as it were, threatened with numberless deaths. So long as it remains uncertain which of them is his fate, I would ask whether it is not better to suffer one and die than to live in fear of all. And so that was a great solace to the hypochondriac inside me. The Magic Kingdom. This morning, I found on a slip of paper tucked into a book, a list of questions I'd written down to ask the doctor. What if it is spread? Is it possible I'm crazy? I've just returned from Florida, from visiting my mother's last sister, who is 80 and doing fine. At the airport, my flight grounded by a storm, I bought a magazine, which fell open to a photograph of three roseate spoonbills tossing down their elegant shadows on a chartreuse field of fertilizer production waste. Two little girls emptied their Ziplocs of Pepperidge Farm goldfish onto the carpet and picked them up one by one with great delicacy before popping them into their mouths. Their mother, outside smoking, kept an eye on them through the glass. After my cousin died, my father died, and then my brother. Next, my father's older brother and his wife. And finally, after my mother died, I expected to die myself. And because this happened very quickly, and because these were really almost all the people I knew, I spent each day smashing dishes with one of my uncle's hammers and gluing them back together in new ways. It was strange work and dangerous, even though I tried to protect myself, wearing a quilted bathrobe and goggles and leather work gloves and opening all the windows, even in snow, against the vapors of the industrial adhesives. Most days now, I get up late and brew coffee, and the smell rises from the old enamel pot I've had to balance under the dark drip ever since the carafe that came with the machine shattered in the dishwasher last month. One morning, I found a lump in my breast, and my vision narrowed to a small dot, and I began to sweat. My legs and arms felt weak, and my heart thrashed behind its bars. We were not written to be safe. In the old tales, the woodcutter's daughter's path takes her each time through the dark forest. There are new words for all of this. A shot of panic becomes the rustle of glucocorticoid, signaling the sympathetic nervous system into a response regulated by the sensitivity of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. And as I go along, these freshly minted charms clatter together in the tender doeskin of the throat, as though the larynx were nothing if not a sack of amulets tied with a cord and worn around the neck. But I tell you, I sat on the bathroom floor for hours trembling. And I can tell you this because the lump was just a lump. And some days now, I don't even dread the end, although I know it will arrive. The garage is filled with buckets of broken china. The girls chase each other and wave their arms, casting spells. The trim of their matching gingham dresses, the electric pink of the bird's wings. They turned each other into princesses and supergirls, and then they pretended to change back. "Oh no, you forgot to say forever." They took turns repeating with dramatic dismay, melting into puddles of themselves, their sandals and sunburned knees vanishing beneath their hems. All right, back to the river twice. So another Roman emperor makes an appearance, has a cameo in this poem, which is called "There Will Never Be Another You," and that is Rudolph II. So we're going into the Middle Ages. Progress is being made. But this is really a poem that has its origin in the very odd fact that John Ashbery and Walter Becker, a founding member of the band Steely Dan, happened to die on the same day. There will never be another you. Maybe everyone who ever wanted to be John Ashbery can be John Ashbery now that John Ashbery is no longer busy being himself. And maybe my former husband, who was always on the lookout for a few good players for a Steely Dan cover band, can be Walter Becker now that Walter Becker is no longer available for gigs. I tell myself I'm not interested in being anyone, though I caught myself admitting over breakfast that the problem with mortality is that I will genuinely miss myself when I'm gone. If I were to pray, I would pray for the world to find a way to put its 7.5 billion axes down. Yesterday, a friend sent me a link to research that found that under electroencephalographic study, the brains of some people were no less moved by flowers than they were by a human face. Their brains lighting up for objects as though the objects were alive. And so I hold the pale, hard body of my aging washing machine in a tender embrace. We are dancing ourselves away from the wall so that I can slip in behind it to install a few feet of flexible hose. I'm also putting in a valve that will know to turn the water off, even if the machine, wishing perhaps to be a water tower, asks for more than it can hold. On the shelf, John Ashbery's poems go on being what they are, just as beside them in a book about the Kunstkammer of Rudolf II, the emperor still paces the ramparts of his castle, awaiting the four horsemen who are bearing drawers, the feast of the rose garlands from Venice to Prague. Classic radio stations will go on playing Peg, playing Deacon Blues, though Walter Becker can no longer spin vinyl to hear the tenor sax of Dexter Gordon contrafacting all the things you are, as I am doing now. The glass door of the wood stove has never wanted to be a tangle of common milkweed, though the afternoon sun brocades it with pink light. In its iron belly, the day is already busy being spent. I have no idea how we're doing for time. I may be at the end of it. This is this is one of the America poems. So as Sarah mentioned, at one time, I thought it was a good idea to write poems of direct address to the country. What was I thinking? And so this is one of those, and this is America, and then the parentheses, it's sort of brackets, it says peaches. America, I know I could do better by you, though I stoop conscientiously 3 times a day to pick up my dog's waste from the grass with black biodegradable bags. Unless you suspect that this is more pretension than allegiance, no, my dog was the one at the shelter no one else would take. He is fat and lazy, and I could do better by him as well, though I do not know if a long walk in the park in 97 degree heat is a good idea. Please cue a presidential soundbite to reassure me all hearts are more resilient than I think. I confess it would have been a moral error to have embraced him if I did not have the means to keep him fed. But I am writing tonight because there is something wrong with your peaches. The ones from the supermarket are so soft and cheap, half the cost of the ones sold at the local farm. But the flesh near the pit is so bitter and green. It is a fruit like the mind we are making together, both overripe and immature. Trust me, I still have the simple tastes you gave me. I am delighted by the common robins and cardinals, the way they set the trees at dusk aflame. Thank you for Tuesday's reliable trash collection. If you were constellated somehow a little bit inside each of your people, I am sorry that there is more and more of you lately. I do not understand. Sometimes I want simply to sit alone a long time in silence. America, you must want this too. Thank you. I think that's going to be it. I think that's the end. It's always so strange.
You can, if you want to go another few minutes, it's completely up to you.
I put one more poem in the pack, and I put it last because it was expendable. It's a poem from my first collection, Correspondence, and I'm reading it because it's got Joseph Cornell in it, and tomorrow I'm going to talk in the craft talk about Joseph Cornell as a kind of analog for poems and how poems can work associatively. If you do not know the work of the assemblagist Joseph Cornell, I recommend you go check it out. He himself is kind of creepy, but the boxes are fascinating. And this is called Romantic Museum. And it's a poem about desire, unexpressed desire. And there's some French words in it, but I'm gonna translate them because my French pronunciation is abysmal. Okay, romantic. Oh, the other thing is there's the word attention in here. And so it's weird because I realize sometimes when I'm reading it, it sounds like attention, but it's not. I mean attention, like focus. Okay. Romantic Museum. For days, I have felt that familiar gravity. Spring again, the worlds aligned, Andromeda, like an insomniac in brightness, glued awake to the false opening at the back of the box. It will pass. I'm waiting for a buzzer to sound, the words of the day, speech act. What if everything you say is said with cunning and beauty, and everything I say is the same? What we say will never be said, having been said meaning arrived, not on the stoop like a package in the rain, but in dry flat letter through the slot. At dawn, the flakes come down the way snow suspends and drops on souvenir New York cities, or catches along the thin struts of a tiny Eiffel Tower in its shaken dime-store dome. City of light. East of the turnpike, just yesterday, empty storage containers the size of rail cars advertised themselves for rent. Stacked like a child's colored blocks, they climb 6 high, 4 deep above the industrial meadow, so that the abandoned brick depots around them look, all the windows black and painless, like Cornell's grand hotels, shrunken outs. Star, swan, setting for a fairy tale, once upon a dark, dark time. What is it about ruin that lures us? What is it in you I sidle beside? I have a friend who has fallen in love for the first time in a long time. And in a dream, her lover is transmogrified, becomes a fawn. We say, vulnerability. Tenderness. All my life, I have practiced reading between the lines, and I can find there anything imaginable, impossible, and nothing too, or not nothing. What feels like it though? The terror of never finding myself again, collecting in a different mouth. My friend confides that her new lover is her muse. Perhaps she adds, you've forgotten how a newness feels. Joseph Cornell lined his basement with the exhausted, cartons of almost worthless windfall, never meant to last. We can scarcely make ourselves consider what it was he craved, what wingless nightmare he exorcised inside each frame. There is a tension within me, still unscattered, unspent, and with it, I fall in and out all the time. We wouldn't call it love. I've been married such a long time. What can I know about the rest? Downpours seen through glass, you, the storm's fresh eye, or more truly, only the idea of eye, the idea of ear, of tongue. Sprung, I fly out safe into the wet, evacuated street. I have made a muse of the near nothing of not knowing if I like it this way, to never tell what I mean. Accumulation, the fierce third rail buried alive beneath the tracks. From the road, who can imagine each box big enough to live in? Any one could hold everything I've got. Later, an afternoon sun breaks out and I wander uptown buying asparagus and a large orange, and they bounce in their small bag like a broken doll, or only its bright, heavy head and a green grove of pickup sticks. Tomorrow, the round cup in my hand will be the warm belly of a bird, the yolk shimmying in the pan, a summer moon rising up into a peppered white photo negative of stars. Sometimes I dream a great bear, sometimes ice, a corrugated warehouse, every hinge sealed shut. But last night I dreamt you simply as yourself. For aren't we even stranger as we really are? Jewel casket, apothecary jar, perhaps sand, perhaps something other. Each grain unopenable and accruing. In a universe more space than material, every atom held together merely by attraction. I am the same trespass, barely bound, dishonest, sincere, yours, unread. That's it. Now I'm really done.
That was beautiful. I'm so glad you read the last poem.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you, audience. My gratitude.
I'll channel all the audience claps into me, I guess. And that's my cat meowing in the background. I guess she's clapping too. Okay, so for those of you who joined after my intro, I'll just quickly recap what happens from here. So Julia McDaniel, one of our MFA students, is going to have about a 30-minute conversation with Kathy, and then we'll open it up to audience questions. If you'd like to submit a question, you can submit it through the chat, unless you indicate, all right, goodness, I'll pick up this cat. Hi, everyone. I'll assume you want me to enable your audio and video so that you can ask your question yourself. If you don't want me to enable your audio and video, just indicate that when you send your question in. And I'll post instructions in the chat as well. So Julia, I will turn it over to you, and I'm sure you guys will have a lovely conversation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ashley. And thanks so much for that beautiful reading. I too am very glad that you read that last poem. Excited to spend some time talking with you. I thought I'd just start out by asking about kind of how the River Twice came to be, when you knew basically that the River Twice was going to be the River Twice, if it started with the Heraclitus fragment, if it started somewhere else.
That's a good question. I don't remember how it started. I think it started with the America poems, actually. I think it started with the America poems because they are in some ways very different from other poems I'd written. They're about the same size and shape as the Marcus Aurelius poems from the Eternal City, but a lot of my poems, as you just endured, are quite long. And so these are not that long. And I was really actively trying to do something that I hadn't done before. I was sort of bored with my process. And then I wrote a few of those, but then I found myself sort of writing back into the kind of long, meditative, essayistic poem that I normally write. And I thought, darn, like I'm writing the same thing. I don't want to do the same thing again. And then I thought of Heraclitus and I said, well, it can't be the same thing. You can't step in the same river twice. Even if I wrote poems about the same material, I'm not the same person and times have changed. The contexts are different. And so I just give myself ongoing permission to just be repetitive. I decided I would call it the River Twice so that it was sort of like secretly announcing, yeah, more of the same.
I love that reflects your own creative process and permission too. That's awesome. I wanted to ask about the America poem specifically too. It was one of my favorite parts of the book. I just was really struck by how you are able to address America and still it doesn't feel like ever any kind of sweeping proclamation. It's just really remarkable. And I was wondering, especially now knowing that's kind of where you started, what was the impetus for the poems and how did you kind of
writing them over a long time? So okay. The America poem Peaches was, you know, I think written in like, you know, more than a decade ago, maybe. I was thinking a lot of those poems are, you know, thinking about, you know, the economic collapse of 2008, 2009, even though that topic, I mean, unfortunately, poverty hasn't gone away. I had been on a traveling fellowship that required me to be abroad for a year. And by the end of the year, I am not a person who I would have said has like a strong attachment to the country. I've never think of myself as having a lot of patriotism or national spirit. But by the end of the year, I was sort of like, I really want to go home. I really want, like, I'm very homesick. And that was a shock to me that I was capable of homesickness was a shock. And so I think it was that reluctant affection that informs the poems that, like, I feel like, you know, America, you've definitely got some problems. You had such great expectations and you have really not lived up to them. And they were wrongheaded. A lot of them were wrongheaded. They were executed poorly. There's a big problem. You're clearly sick. We don't know what's wrong with you. Let me just like sit here and visit with you a while as though you're like an elderly parent or something who's like, failing. Anyway, that was my attitude. And then I mean, in a way, it was a gift to start them such a long time ago, because I was able, I think, to maintain that sort of neutral distance and not get rage, you know, not find myself, like, you know, certainly there's many times when I felt rage in the last recent years. And you're not even that. In the last year alone, I felt a lot of that. And so I'm glad that I don't necessarily, that would have been a very hard, rage poems are hard for me to write.
Yeah, thank you for that. It's, yeah, it makes sense to me to know they were written over a long period of time and perhaps even thinking or being in different places. Within the country. Yeah. And maybe that relates, well, you can tell me to another like quality of the book that I really enjoyed and wanted to ask about, which is the way you navigate really beautifully this blurring or inextricability between the we and the I. I think Sarah even quoted that in the intro, but there's a line where you, in Self-Portrait with the Sleeping Man, where you write, "Sometimes I forget that I cannot say I, or I assume that you know that when I say I mean we." I just was really struck by that and wanted to know, just wanted to ask you if you could talk a little more about how you thought about the I and the we.
I feel like that's the big, you know, I don't know if it's an existential, it's certainly a philosophical and ethical question of our time is, you know, who can speak for, you know, what other person? And if I can't speak for, I wouldn't presume to speak for someone, then what does this say about our capacity for empathy, right? So I was really, that was one of the last poems that I wrote for this book. And so that's a very contemporary poem and that's a really contemporary question. Like, I really don't know how to position myself in relation to any other, like, you know, right? And so I want to position myself. I mean, for, you know, most of my life, I had the luxury of having some sort of sense of universal humanity and a kind of essential shared experience across like all time. So hence my fascination with Heraclitus and Marcus Aurelius and, Augustine and And then to suddenly, like, you know, really obviously this is something that comes out of like post-structuralism. This isn't a new idea, but to suddenly realize that actually people's experiences are really very, very, very different. And what are you gonna do with that? And then also just the idea that the self is a very nebulous, shifting, changey thing. And I'm not even exactly sure where I come down philosophically on the idea, the notion of a unified self. And so I'm trying to just sort of say, like, there's a problem. We've got this problem. What are we gonna do with it? I don't know what to do with it. I want to act morally. I want to write morally, but I don't even know how to locate myself in relation to you linguistically. So I hope that's an answer. So yeah, so I tried, sometimes I feel like I want to say we, because I'm not, you know, I feel like what I'm saying is inclusive, right? And so it feels important to say, like, I get it. This is something that many of us, at least if not all of us, have in common and share, and I can assert this.
Yeah, I know. I definitely think that's an answer. I think I also feel those questions in the poem, which is,
yeah. And so I didn't know what, I mean, by the time I got to the end of the book, it was, those were really urgent. That was a really urgent question. And I thought, well, I don't know how, I didn't know how to write. I didn't know what pronouns to, like, how to suddenly my pronouns became really problematic. And I thought, well, I'm just going to put it out there. I'm just going to admit it. Like, this is a problem that I'm wrestling with. And I take it seriously. I take this problem seriously. So.
Yeah, you saying that makes me want to ask but both about the epigraphs and notes and about your relationship with Heraclitus, because I see those questions being, like, there's some light being shown there. But maybe I'll just start by asking what your relationship to Heraclitus is, like, what keeps you interested in?
I have been in love with Heraclitus since I was a teenager. I think he's, you know, because he's been rendered so broken. And, you know, first of all, I think it's highly likely that he had a very attractive world philosophy, you know, metaphysics. I think his metaphysics was quite interesting. It has a lot of, you know, Buddhist overtones to it. It's not really clear where he may have traveled, where those ideas sort of became pollinated and cross-pollinated. But then the fact that you take this thing that was probably pretty provocative anyway, and then you just break it. So it's like a gigantic erasure. You're left with things that sound really, you know, inviting to write your way into or to think about. And so, I mean, I think that he has this, I mean, the river twice, it is, I mean, I think that's a great metaphor for the self, right? It is, we certainly feel that we have a unified self. I mean, that, so I don't feel, you know, fragmented necessarily internally. I certainly experience the world as, you know, whole, as one being, as a singular consciousness and sensibility, yet it is always evolving and it is always changing. And I certainly would say, like, oh, I'm not the person I was then. I'm not even the person I was 5 years ago. I'm not even the person I was last year. Are you kidding me? Yeah. So Heraclitus sort of gives you a way to think about how both of those things could be true. And a lot of this thinking is like that. It's very oppositional. And he gives you a way to sort of say, like, it's possible for these two seeming contradictions to be reconciled.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense to me. Yeah. Well, you saying that just kind of brought to mind, actually, my own experience of returning to the river twice. It's kind of funny because of COVID, when you were originally, I had the experience of reading with kind of attentive focus, exactly at the start of the pandemic and then kind of a year in, which was very funny. So it was almost like this time capsule of like, not only the text, but also like, you know, myself as I was returning to it. And so as I was doing that, I was thinking about like how a lot of people have talked about this as a, like a lost year, and how that just doesn't ring true to me. And how a lot of your poems kind of wrestle with our inability to bank time and how things kind of run over each other and no two seasons are the same. All of which is kind of a long way of asking, you know, having been through the same experience that we've all been through in this year, how are you thinking about time and seasons now? And has the experience of this past year impacted your writing?
Well, yes, it has, and not in a good way. I felt, you know, that the weight of the questions that we were talking about pronouns and the relationship of the self to others, and whose voice needs to be foregrounded in this moment, has been a weighed very heavily on me, and to the point of which I just really don't know how to insert, how to speak into the current climate, but what I have been thinking of is, so sometimes I need, and I need the title of the collection first, and so I think that this is really, you know, I'm thinking that it would be like previously and through or something like that, and so that it gives me permission to write about, like, when I was reading these poems, I just thought, like, how crazy, like, this is a poem in which I went to a thrift shop. What was I thinking? Like, this is like a disease, it's like a petri dish in there, you know, and so many things seem, you know, alien, but to sort of think about the way things were, you know, previously, and I think that's from just streaming so much, like this year, right, previously on such and such a show, and so like previously we lived this way, and then the idea of through is, in general, I tend to take a text or a work of art of some kind, or, you know, something, and look through it at the world, like through that mediating lens. And so through feels to me both about looking at the world maybe through a new set of experiences, through the eyes of another person, but also enduring, just getting through this. It seems sort of miraculous. Yeah, I've got my first, it's in this arm, my first COVID vaccine. So, you know, I'm looking forward to getting the second one.
Congratulations. I feel like I want to clap every time I hear that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Yeah, thank you for that answer. Before I open up, I wanted to shift to just a couple questions about and a structure of the book, which I just get geeky about and loved. But I wanted to ask how you were thinking about the epigraphs and the notes in the book. I was sharing with a couple of people recently that I love how conversational your notes are. Like, I don't think I've read notes that feel like more immediate, is how I would describe it, in a book of poetry. And I just wonder, how do you decide like what you included as an epigraph versus in the notes? And how do you think about the function of those things?
The epigraph, it usually feels to me like it is in some way essential to, it needs to be on the same page, that it somehow frames the poem, or it creates again, a lens through which you read the text, right? And so with Marcus Aurelius' poems, it's not, I mean, sometimes the ideas are fairly tangential, but one of the things that does carry through is a sort of relationship to syntax and grammar and elevated diction. So the Aurelius translation that I used is pretty old fashioned. But I liked that about it. I liked what that did to my own language when I found myself writing in response to it. It sort of like made me step into that sort of diction and that sort of grammatical structure, sentence structures. And so I feel like the epigraph is in some way has to be on the same page. But I often, you know, I want to get like a ton of facts into the poem. And sometimes the poem, like, I was talking with students today, and like the poem just can't take any more facts. Like it just refuses. It says enough. Uncle, if you put one more fact in me, I'm going to fall apart. And then you're going to be stuck with a really big, ugly mess. And so I don't want to, once the poem feels like it's on the teetering brink of what it can, when it can accommodate, then I will, you know, shove an epigraph that I need, if I feel like I really need it in there. And that's, yeah, that is it. And then everything else, I really believe in giving credit where credit is due. And so the notes are really sort of about like, hey, these are the things that, there's a bunch of, you know, sampled stuff in these poems, and I really want you to know where they came from, and I want to point you to these texts that I love. And I thought that Princeton was going to call me out on the notes, you know. I just started writing them, and I was like, you know what, I'm going to go like crazy with these notes. I'm going to be really indulgent. I'm just going to write like, I'm going to make them like their own book. The notes are going to be like their own thing. And then they didn't call me out on it. They let it go through, which is sort of amazing. And so it's just got this really wild note section at the end.
Well, I was very glad.
I was having a lot of fun. I just said, I'm going to have fun with you. Because writing the note section can be a really onerous task, like really thankless. You feel like no one's reading it. And then so I thought, well, if I'm going to do it, I'm going to have fun doing it. And I did. I had a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think that comes through. I think there's still your voice there, which is cool. I asked the last question I'll ask for opening it up. I'm sure many in this room who are ordering our thesis. Would just love to ask, you know, how you approached the structure of your book, how you arrived at five sections, or how you thought about the order and structure of the book more generally.
I was in conferences today, I spoke about this a little bit. I actually get little like pieces of index cards out, and I write the name of the poem, and then I write its sort of thematic concerns, the best that I can name them. Sometimes I'm like, oh, what's this about? and then I write how many pages it is in the corner. And then I sort of lay them out, and I sort of start to see, you know, shared clusters of concern. And so then I make piles like as though there were suits of cards, and I cluster them by their concerns. And then, I usually take what I think is the clearest articulation of the concerns, of each of the concerns, and put those in the front so that somebody reading the book will like get grounded very quickly into the variety of subject matter that they might encounter as the book progresses. And then for the rest of the book, I start to think about, you know, I tend to have like a heterogeneous mix. I tend not to do thematic clusters, or if I do a thematic cluster, it's not what you would think of on the surface of something. It might be some deep, poems that reference science. Like they might be together, though their thematic concerns are really different, but they share this weird science angle or something. And that's how I do it. But then I also really bear in mind the reader and what I think the reader can tolerate. And so I make as many, because my poems are long, I often won't have that many poems in a section, because I feel like the reader needs to believe that there's going to be a point at which they can put the book down. I want them to be able to look ahead and go like, oh, five more pages. Oh, there's only five poems in this section. Okay, there's a rest area up ahead. I can make it. And we don't have to pull off the road. And so I want to keep them driving through the book, but I want to make sure that they feel that it's an invite. It's been organized in a way that makes the trip bearable. And so often I'll put like a long poem and a short poem. And sometimes at the end, they have to write short poems because the book would be unbearable otherwise.
Thank you so much for that answer. That's really helpful. It is, yeah. I know other folks have questions, so I'll turn over to Ashley.
So, all right. So our first question is from Marlon, who is a University of Michigan undergraduate student.
Hey there.
Hi, I'm Marlon. I'm a sophomore at Michigan, and I'm taking my first creative writing class this semester. And so my question was regarding like workshopping, because I get so nervous and like self-conscious about my writing. So I just want to know how you're able to like go into like workshop, get feedback, and not take it like so personally and get like, because sometimes I feel like I would get not as excited to keep writing when people critique my work, you know? So I just want to know how you deal with that.
I think that's the real like trouble with workshop, or not trouble, but that's the challenge of workshop, right? Is that you want to set an atmosphere as the workshop leader that you want people to learn, but mostly you want them to keep writing and you want them to stay alive. So those are the things that you're hoping to achieve in a beginning level workshop. I always stress to my students that the poem is a made thing. It's like a machine. If you were in, when you were a kid, when I was a kid, we had like home economics and shop, right? And so in home economics, you sewed clothing, and in shop, you made like a bookshelf or something. You cut wood and built things. And so I try to say to my students that the poem is like that. It's the same thing. It's a craft. If you sew a skirt and the hem is crooked, you just take the hem out and you fix it. Or like, oh, that pocket isn't, I forgot to open the pocket. I can't get my hand, the pocket's there, but I forgot to open the seam where the pocket is. Okay, you go in and you just get a seam ripper and you open the pocket. You know, nobody stops sewing for a lifetime because the first skirt they ever made is not perfect. Or people like, you know, sometimes I would sew things, you know, I like sew stuffed animals and people are like, what is it? Is it a bear? Is it a whale? What is it? Like, it was so bad, you know, they couldn't even identify it. And so that's the way to think about your poem. What did you want the poem to be? What is the people are looking at it or should be looking at it with an attitude of saying like, what was the poet trying to make? How can we help them like get better at making this thing they're trying to make? So I try really hard to like say, the poem is not me. There's this gap between me and the poem. The poem is just something I made. And it was the best that I could make at that moment. But in 10 years from now, I hope I can do a better job if I keep trying, if I keep practicing. And so I sort of just try to think of those drafts as practice. And I like, this is it, I practiced. What wasn't right? Does that help at all?
Yeah, I feel like that idea of just like it's not a personal attack. Because sometimes I think like if I'm writing about like a personal poem, then like when they critique it, it's like a critique on me. But I guess technically that's not the case because it's just
they're not critiquing your feelings or your life or what happened to you or what it is you're writing about. The subject matter is not what's under, you know, discussion. What's under discussion is like, how did you shape it? Right? Could the container for this really important, essential, and tender experience, is there a way for the container to actually be more worthy of it, of what you're trying to say? And that's, you know, I think the way that you would think of that is like, and then you don't have to listen to them either. Just saying, like, it's your poem. I mean, really, at the end of the day, it's your poem. So I don't mean, I wouldn't advise you to tell your workshop teacher, like, I'm not revising this, or I don't think you're right. Because I think you probably eventually will learn more and you'll be like, oh yeah, yeah, whatever, I see now this thing. But you know, you also can, I mean, I just always say, like, I've got this thing, I made it, I'm putting it in a folder, and it's untouchable in that space. And I can play around with it and turn and do all kinds of things, and I can satisfy all the revision requirements that I need to do. But if at the end of the day, I still feel closer to the one that I started with, I still have that one. Nothing has happened to it.
Yeah. Thanks so much. That's really helpful.
Good luck. That's the most important thing. Good drafting.
Thank you.
All right. Our next question I'm going to read. It's from Maria, who is one of our postgraduate Zell fellows. And she says, I wanted to pick up on the idea of a poem overflowing with facts. Could you talk a bit about your drafting and revision process and the role research plays in your process?
Ooh, okay. Well, this is sort of segues back to that, believe it or not, the question about workshop, and that one of the ways that I defend myself from that feeling of having put myself on the line is that I often begin the poem not by talking about myself, but by talking about something else that I found interesting. So something I read in the newspaper, something I saw on TV, you know, a magazine article, a novel I'm reading, a photograph, whatever, something that is exterior to me and apart from my life. And I start by talking about that. And I believe that, like, inevitably I'm going to get to whatever it is that I have to say. Like, you just can't stop it. Like, there is something burning inside you, and you're going to, and it's going to have its expression. It's going to find its way. So no matter where I start, I will wind my way to whatever it is that is urgently in need of expression. But I create this distance, like right off the bat, where I can bear, I can tolerate being in the poem, and I can eventually tolerate talking about this urgent thing because I've kind of built this other wall of all these facts and all this other exterior rumination. And so I often start with the other thing. I start with the thing that fascinates me. And then ultimately I get to a point in the poem where I've said just about everything I can think of about this thing. And then I have to start asking myself, like, well, why are you even interested in this thing? Like, what is in it for you? And then I just play a game with myself and I say, like, what's the first memory that pops into your head? Or what did you do this morning? Or what did you do yesterday? And I just write that into the poem and see where that takes me. And then something else will pop into my head. I'll make another, like, I'll have another association. I was like, oh yeah, this reminds me, what was that book I read? Like, what was that thing about? I don't even know, like, clear-cut forest growing mushrooms now or something, you know? So there's a book of mushrooms at the end of the world. So I might, like, say, like, oh, you know, like, sometimes out of devastation, something really complicated and beautiful arises. And so I just, yeah, I just follow I let my mind wander. I have learned to trust it. And you know, I think there's some scientific evidence for why we should. Those synapses are there for a reason, just ride them. And then the revision process, you could sort of say, like, whoa, that was a cul-de-sac, that was a dead end. I don't know what this is doing in here. But in the inception of generating the draft, I don't even know what it's about. So why would I start precluding things when the poem hasn't even found its subject yet? So that's sort of how I go.
Awesome. All right, our next question is from Mira, who is an undergraduate student in English 223, which is our creative writing course. So Mira, you can go ahead and ask your question.
Hey there.
Hi, it's great to hear from you. I've really loved hearing everything you've said so far, and it's so interesting to hear you just discuss all these poems in The River Twice. So yes, like Ashley said, I'm a freshman in English 223, wow. And I'm in my first creative writing class. And I have a question about some of your like subject material and how you deal with it. Okay. So in many of your poems, you grapple with a fragmented sense of self. And despite, like you just expressed, you often feel like one being, it seems as though you've given the topic a lot of thought. So how do you avoid feeling like bogged down by these thoughts in your daily interactions? Like, in other words, how do you delineate between the self that's doing all this thought and then, you know, the person that's just like spending time talking with their friends about like clothes and the weather? And then sort of the same vein, just like, how do you find levity when writing about all these heavy, intense and urgent feeling things?
I think honestly, you have it harder than I did. There's a, you know, I'm thinking of Bob, there's a line from Bob Dylan where he, my back pages, and he says, oh, I was so much older than, I'm younger than that now. And I think that when I was your age, I was just so serious. I was just like I expected every conversation to be very deep. I was reading all the time. I was just starved for intellectual stimulation. And then that went on for a really long time. I mean, I think I came from a very like uneducated, you know, carnival family. And so I felt this great sense of inadequacy. And I felt like I was just trying to somehow bridge this gap between the worldly, sophisticated intellectual that I wanted to be and who I thought of I really was. And then gradually over time, and it took decades before I could finally like laugh at myself or just take joy in simple, like you're saying, like clothes shop. I mean, I always loved a thrift shop. So that was always, there's always that escape for me. But to just be like simple and not be like, if I did something simple and silly, to not feel like that was a diminishment somehow of whatever this other idealized sense of self that was hampering me and was a real burden to live under. So I lighten up. No, so I don't have an answer for how to get the perspective, but for me, it just took time. I got better at it and I got less, the older I got, the less serious I've become. But I think I just had I had to spend that time being that serious person. That was a part of the journey for me. I wish I had an easier answer for that.
Oh, thank you so much, Kathy. That is all the questions from the audience that we've received so far. So I will turn it back over to Julia and the two of you can continue chatting. Oh, we've got one more question from the audience here. I'll let you ask a question, Julia, and then I'll bring up this next one.
Yeah, sounds good. It kind of jumps off part of what was said anyway. I had wanted to ask about what you were reading and about teaching a little bit. The question I'll just pick is, what are you reading lately and what are you teaching anything that you're really excited about to your own students right now?
Oh, I knew you were gonna ask that question and I'm still drawing a blank. I designed a class in the fall that I really loved teaching, and that was called Salvage as Metaphor and Method. And I think because I'm such a junkaholic, it was really fun. But then we also just looked at books that dealt with salvage, and some of it was in poetry. It was a mixed genre class. And so if you haven't, I really loved Lincoln and the Bardo by George Saunders. People may not love that, but I mean, that's the ultimate salvage, I think, right there. I mean, when you're salvaging the soul. But then there's just been a lot of, I think that poetry is more interested in form than it has been in a long time. And so I'm teaching a class now in form and theory. And so we looked at sort of Jericho Brown and Roger Reeves. And Jericho Brown's got his duplex poems, which are sort of half guzzle, half, or half gazelle and half, I don't even know what sonnet, right? They're all 14 lines. And so I've been thinking about that, about the turn in contemporary poetry. I've got the DMZ colony right here. And so I'm thinking about hybrid format, really thinking a lot about that. I find it like that a book could look like this is amazing to me. And so that is, and I just started Clara and the Sun, the Ishiguro novel. And I had before that read Parable of the Sower because I'm thinking about updating the salvage class. And so I can see why Parable of the Sower feels timely. I don't know if you know it, it's Octavia Butler. It's a sort of speculative fiction, but I didn't love the writing style, but when I went to the Ishiguro, I was like, oh, I love the writing style. Yeah, so anyway, so I'm enjoying that. And it's not poetic, it's fiction. And I went going back to that other question, like there were years, like I just did not have time for fiction. Like that's how serious I was. I was like, no fiction, yeah.
Thank you for that. I want to take both those classes. I have more questions I could ask, but I want to let folks.
Okay, there's a letter, the letter A has appeared.
Yes, so our next question is from Alejandro, who is a U of M undergraduate student.
Okay.
Hi, I can't say I'm familiar with your work, but I, listening to you read, there were some moments where I was literally just like floored, like at the ending of like, I guess like my main question is, you have these endings sometimes, like the one at the end of The Magic Kingdom, or the one at the end of There Will Never Be Another You, where you kind of just end on this just very, this like image that maybe isn't super, super meaningful, but has like that feeling to it. Like the idea of the door of the oven turning into milkweed and then the day dying like inside of it, or the image of like the girls like vanishing into the hem of their dresses. How do you give yourself that kind of permission to not do something like kind of like I'm gonna give this like big axiomatic poetic truth at the end of this poem, or do something like very big and meaningful and just have this kind of like fading kind of softer sort of just existing thing that we're left on?
I do that on purpose. So yes, thank you for picking pointing to that. I really believe that the image is, that it is imaginative writing. The key to the universe is the image. It's all about the image all the time. Well, so I was a philosophy student as an undergraduate. And so I've had it like up to here with the big axiomatic world building, like symbolic logic claims. No, that's not true. I love it. Like, I'm still reading Heraclitus, but they work differently, right? They have a, the limit of what they assert is pretty circumscribed, right? If you express an idea and you express it articulately, it means what it means, right? An image isn't like that. An image means so much, an image means many things at one time simultaneously. An image has a ton of connotations and interpretations, and they are all boom, right? Like you give the image boom, and everything in that image is delivered in that instant. Whereas if I were to try to say like, and this is the poem about the fact that we're mortal and we die, that would not nearly be as provocative as, like, to me, that image at the end of The Magic Kingdom is also like conjures the Wizard of Oz, and I'm melting, like, you know, so all of that is in there, and I don't have to say it, which is, to me, the Wizard of Oz is like sort of the ultimate, evocation of childhood that's also somehow scary at the same time. So that's my answer. My answer is I believe the image can do more than the claim. I think the image contains the claim and then some. It's added value. But if you feel like you need to say the claim, because sometimes people are just like, I don't know what your poem is about. Like, you need to tell me what your poem is about. So I will sometimes put into the poem what the poem is about. This is a poem about X. And I'll have the claim, but I don't end on it. I like to end on the image.
Thank you. I sometimes like end poems like that. And I'm like, is this like right to do? And I just like was running at what your thought process behind it is.
Yeah, I think it's very right to do it.
Sorry, I was muted there for a sec. All right, so our next question is from Laura, who is an MFA student at Northwestern. Okay. So Laura, and I think she's just gonna use audio. Whatever you prefer, Laura.
Thank you. Yes, thanks. My internet is in and out here, but I wanted to thank you for this. And were there any prompts that you could share that you use with your students? Some of your favorite prompts or?
Well, I love an ekphrastic prompt because it, you know, gets them out of their own way. Like lots of times my students want, they, you know, sort of what we were talking about, they really want to, they have things that are very important and they're that's their go-to is to start with this most tenderest thing. And then it's really hard because you don't, you know, it's hard to workshop a poem that's about the very core of someone's being. You know, you're just like, you know what, let's just let this be. Like that is what it is, and let's just let it alone and not start put it on the operating table and dissect it. And so I try to do what I can to get students to write poems that they are invested in, but their investment is at least in part aesthetic and not completely emotional. And so I find like ekphrastic poems work really well. I often ask students to write imitations, like I'll assign a poet from an anthology and I'll say, here are, you know, a dozen poems by, my form and theory are doing odes now. And so here are a dozen odes, write an ode, like based on like sort of almost like reverse engineering it, right? Like, so I can, you know, obviously they had craft essays and historical essays to read about the ode, but mostly I just wanted them to say like, what are these, you've got 12 odes, what based on these poems, what do you think odes are? What do they do? How do they work? Imitate what you perceive to be some of the gestures that odes can make and do it. And you know, do it about something really stupid. The stupidest thing you can sing an ode to, go for it. You know, I might give them Ross Gay's Book of Delights for that. And so imitations, ekphrastic persona poems, things that I usually for undergraduates, they do really well. Epistolary poems, a poem as a letter. They do well when I can just give them that little permission to step back from themselves. You know, get out of their own way.
Thank you. That's so helpful.
All right. Our next question is from Diane, who is a U of M alumna and a big fan of the Zell Visiting Writer Series. So Diane, you can go ahead and ask your question.
Kathleen, I'm so honored. I so appreciate and I just love your word flow. I was wondering, I find so interesting too, your background and the way that you found expression in writing and in poetry. And I was wondering when you were starting out, was it important to you, you know, given overcoming the, not overcoming, but coming to deal with that trajectory, was it important to you to prioritize how you would express getting yourself out into the world in terms of getting recognition through an award, or how did you go about that in terms of launching yourself in poetry?
I was really fortunate in that, I didn't have to do a lot and I was mostly fortunate in that I had really low expectations. I was almost 40. When I said, I think I want to learn how to write a poem. And so I was old enough to know that I was really likely to fail. like, I was likely not to learn to write very good poems. And my teacher was the poet Stephen Dunn, and he was very also really honest about the fact that, you know, don't quit your day job, sweetie. So I didn't have an expectation, and that was a liberation. And I just worked really hard on writing the best poems that I was capable of writing, even though like they were flawed. I just want to say this to everyone who has asked a question, like my best poems when I first started writing were really bad. Like I worked really hard on them and they were terrible. I mean, I was 40 years old and taking an undergraduate creative writing workshop. And often I would leave there and get in my car and go like, okay, I had the worst poem again this week. You know, sort of like mentally ranking them. So that is it. I just worked on doing the best that I could. And I think that the answer to your question is that if a great opportunity were to present itself, right? Like you meet somebody in the airport, you know, and you're like, whoa, you know, a famous poet in the airport who could hook me up. Unless the work is there to back up the encounter, it doesn't matter, right? So the person says, oh, you're a poet. I'd love to see your poems. Here's my email address. Send me your manuscript. Well, if the manuscript isn't a knockout, it doesn't matter that you got lucky enough to meet this person that published the editor from Copper Canyon in the airport. You know, the work has to be good. And so that's all I ever like concentrated on, was writing the best poem.
Thank you so much. It's been a treasure to speak with you.
Well, thank you.
All right, I think we should have time for one more question. This question is from Lauren, who is a University of Michigan undergrad.
Okay.
Take it away, Lauren.
Hi, Lauren.
Hello, thank you for being here. First, I'd like to say it was funny how you talked about doing imitation poems, because my class has done something similar with your poem, so that was an enjoyable experience.
Oh. Are you sure that was an enjoyable experience?
I surely enjoyed it. So my question is, as a reader and a writer, how important are the non-content related parts of poetry to you? So for example, how it sounds, so like the rhythm or alliteration and other tools used, and the shape of the poem on the page. So I guess how
important. There isn't a difference. That's the thing. The form is the content. So because what are you doing with the poem, right? The poem is trying to get whatever is here and here, here, right? And so part of doing that is orchestrating it, right, for the reader or the viewer. You want them to experience the way that you're experiencing it. And so you just would think about filmmaking, right? There's a close-up, right? And then there's like two people talking, you see this head, then you see this head, then you see this head, then it pans back, right? And then maybe it pans up, and then there's a jump cut and suddenly we're in another town. And then there's a thing across the bottom 10 years earlier, right? And so all of those things that films do, those are formal moves, gestures, right? Cinematic gestures. And we know how to read those and interpret those and understand those. And the poem is the same way. It's got, if you've read enough and you've spoken enough, you start to develop, this is what I say to my students. I'm like a dog with an earache or something. I'm scratching my ear. And I'm like, can you, you know, it doesn't sound right, or it sounds great or something, but it's all like, how's it sound? How's the rhythm? You know, and so I do always listen to that. Sometimes it can be, you know, you have to walk, I'm a free verse poet, so you don't want to be like overwhelmed where like it's a tongue twister, you know, but yeah, the rhythm. And then also, what's it look like on the page? Because that also says a lot. Like, you know, I think a lot about like, oh, that's some scary stuff. You know, like, do I want some, you know, how much does it, you know, do I need stanza breaks? Do I need white space? How can I just like get this, pace it, right? I want to pace it. I want to get the information out to the reader at a certain, is it a speedy poem? Is it a slow poem? And the lineation can communicate, and the white space can communicate all of that. Yeah, so the form matters.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Yay. Well, I'm sorry to say that we are just about out of time. Kathy, thank you so much. This has been such a vibrant, real discussion. And we are very lucky to have Kathy Graber back with us tomorrow morning for her craft lecture titled The Art of Association. And that is open to the public as well. It's the same link as today's event. And I also posted a link in the chat to sign up for our email list and to purchase Kathy's books from Literati, which is our wonderful local bookstore. They do curbside pickup and mail order. So wherever you are, they can send it to you. So have a great evening, everyone. You're welcome to send little messages through the chat if you'd like, and we'll hope to see you tomorrow.
Thank you so much, everyone. Right. Thank you. What a wonderful evening. I'm going to sit here and read the chat.
Bye, everyone.